Hi, this is Jeffrey Reddick, creator of Final Destination.
Greetings, Slashaholics. This is David Bergantino, author of the Freddy Krueger's Tales of Terror books, the Bard's Blood Horror Shakespeare books.
Hey guys, this is Jason Brooks, Jason Voorhees from Friday the 13th Vengeance.
Hey, this is Slasher Pepper.
Hey everybody, it's CJ Graham, Jason, Friday the 13th, part 6.
This is William Pattison, known to Friday the 13th fans as Eric Morris.
Hi, this is Deborah Voorhees from Friday the 13th, part 5.
Hey folks, this is Adam Marcus, director of Jason Goes to Hell and Secret Santa.
Hello kiddies, this is John Kassir, the voice of the Crypt Keeper.
Hi, this is Kane Hodder, better known as Jason from Friday the 13th, Victor Crowley from Hatchet.
And you're listening.
You're listening.
And you're listening.
And you're listening.
I just want to make sure you guys know you're listening.
You are listening.
And you are listening.
And you are lucky enough to be listening.
Okay, boils and ghouls, you are listening.
You are listening
to the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
The 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To 80s Slasher Librarian.
To 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian.
To the 80s Slasher Librarian. Keep listening, or I'll kill you.
Tonight's upload is brought to you by our patrons from the Patreon page. That's Cecilia Spears, Hawaii, Carl Leakins, Catherine McClear, Sean Campbell, Iron Alexa, Allison Seib, Ryan Woodward, TikTok 12, Bree, Bonanza Jellybean, and Kai Antez. Thank you guys so much for supporting the channel through Patreon. And if anybody listening right now enjoys the content of the 80 Slasher Librarian YouTube channel, and would like to help keep it going and growing for a long time to come, then click the link in the description below and sign up on Patreon for as low as $2 to $5 per month. You get some great rewards depending on the tier you select, such as the $2 tier gets you the early access content, the $5 tier gets you the early access plus a free ebook emailed to you every 3 months, and every 12 months you get a free gift from the merch store. There's also a $15 tier that gets you a free gift from the merch store every 6 months, a free ebook every 3 months, and you can appear on the podcast and voice a character in an audiobook narration once per month. So there's many choices to choose from. Just click the Patreon link in the description below and check it out. Child's Play 2, The Novelization. Chapter 12. Andy sat at the wooden kitchen table waiting for Joanne to finish with his breakfast. He would have been just as happy with a bowl of Captain Crunch, but she was fixing him something special. She didn't look so pretty this morning. She didn't look really awake yet. When his mom woke him up, she was usually all dressed with her makeup on and some perfume, all ready for work. But Joanne was flopping around in slippers and a big fluffy white bathrobe, doing something very strange to an egg. She opened the egg with a quick crack to the side of the blender. Then she dropped it into a strainer, the kind his mom used for spaghetti and Andy used for a helmet. The clear, gummy part of the egg dripped into the blender, joining a banana that sat in a pool of orange juice. When all the clear stuff had dripped down, covering the banana with goo, Joanne moved the strainer with the eye-like yolk to the sink, covered the blender, and turned it on. It made a loud whirring noise. Joanne turned and smiled at Andy, and he smiled back. So far, it didn't look like any eggs he had ever had before. He hated the noise of the blender, though. He wanted to put his hands on his ears, but he thought that maybe she'd be mad. "I want to act how they want me to act," he thought. "It's better here than at the center." Sometimes in the center, Andy had had the feeling that he'd never get out. He felt as if he'd stay there until he was all grown up and maybe even beyond that. But here, with the morning sun bouncing off the wooden table, he could imagine the doorbell ringing, and he'd hurry to the window and see his mom's car. Then he'd run to the door, to a big hug from his mother. "I'm not here forever," he told himself. "And they're nice people." He looked at Kyle, who was looking at a magazine and chewing on a mouthful of Cheerios. "They're kinda nice." "There," Joanne said. "It's all done." She smiled again, pushing her hair off her forehead. She took the blender off its base and poured a great big Mickey Mouse glass full of the mixture. It was still orange, like the orange juice, but when she placed the glass in front of him, Andy could see that the mixture was paler, with tiny strands running through it. It reminded him of a picture in his old first grade class. It was one of the planets. It looked like Jupiter.
"Bon appetit,"
Kyle said, looking over at him. Joanne stood next to him. "She's waiting to watch me drink it," he knew. "She wants to see if I like it." He thought of the egg, the runny, clear glop, and the banana spinning around. His stomach felt tight. "It's an egg shake, Andy," Joanne patted his shoulder. "You'll like it." He looked up at her, hesitant.
"My mom used to cook eggs."
Kyle laughed. "Oh," Joanne said. "Well, Phil says..." Kyle jumped in.
"Phil says,"
she said, sounding as if she had memorized the words,
"that the grease used in cooking accounts for 30% of the excess body fat in the average American."
Kyle leaned closer to Andy.
"And don't even get him started on cholesterol."
Andy picked up the glass. He took a breath. Joanne just stood there watching him, waiting. He brought the glass to his lips and then he took a sip. It was horrible. It was one of the worst things he had ever tasted. Worse than that cold medicine Dr. Wormley prescribed. The orange stuff that Andy hated. This was much worse.
"Do you like it?" Joanne asked.
Andy nodded. He looked up at her, but her face didn't look happy.
"She knows I hate it," he thought.
"I do,"
he added. But Joanne put her hands in the pocket of her bathrobe and shrugged.
"That's okay, Andy. You didn't have to drink it."
She turned away, and Kyle leaned close to him, whispering, telling him something he already knew.
"You hurt her feelings."
He looked over at Joanne, standing facing the sink, rinsing out the strainer and then grabbing the blender. And he looked at his nearly full Mickey Mouse glass. He reached out and brought the glass to his lips. He chugged the liquid, letting the gummy taste run over his lips. He kept drinking it until the glass was empty, and then he slammed it down. Joanne turned, with a big smile on her face now.
"Oh, so you did like it," she said.
Andy nodded. He felt Kyle watching him.
"Do you want some more?" Joanne asked.
"I feel kind of full,"
Andy said. Joanne, still smiling, nodded and moved to the foyer. She called out,
"Phil, breakfast is getting old."
"Time for Phil's batch,"
Kyle whispered. Andy sat there listening to Phil's heavy steps coming down the stairs, but he didn't come straight into the kitchen. He turned away into the living room, Andy guessed. Andy hadn't looked in that room this morning. He didn't want to see that stupid good guy there, and he tried to keep away this thought. What if it's not there?
Joanne came back into the kitchen and ruffled his hair. "You better get ready to go out and play, Andy," she said. "First day, we don't want to be..." He heard a crunch. They all heard a crunch. And Phil said a word Andy knew but wasn't supposed to use. "Damn!" Kyle surfaced from her magazine and cereal. She looked at Andy, then Joanne. Everyone waited while Phil walked into the kitchen. He had something in his hand. "What is it?" Joanne said. "What's..." Phil leaned over the kitchen table and turned his hands over, and a bunch of broken pieces of pottery clattered onto the table. Andy looked at the broken object. He saw the sharp, jagged edges and tiny pieces, but he didn't see what it was, couldn't recognize it until... He saw the baby intact, looking up with big eyes at nothing, because the mother was in 100 shattered pieces. Andy looked up at Phil. "Do either of you have anything to say?" Phil asked. Andy looked back at the statue. "He thinks I did it," Andy thought. "Because of what happened yesterday, he thinks I broke the statue." Kyle cleared her throat.
"I think we should talk to our lawyers first."
"Hey, don't be a wise ass, Kyle. This isn't funny." Phil looked back to Andy, talking right to him. "That was a very expensive statue, and I've told both of you not to touch it." He moved closer to Andy. "What did I tell you yesterday, the first day you got here?" Andy licked his lips. "Now one of you did this, and one of you owes Joanne an apology. And maybe a new statue." Joanne leaned out and picked up the baby. "Phil, maybe..."
"I'm innocent. That's all I know,"
Kyle announced. She shoved another spoonful of Cheerios into her mouth. "Andy?" Phil demanded.
I...
He looked at Joanne.
"I didn't do it,"
Phil grunted. "Look, did you come down here last night, Andy? One of you's gotta be lying. One of you..." His voice was getting louder. Joanne leaned out and touched his arm.
"Phil, please. Lighten up, honey. It's just a statue. We can get another, and..."
"Andy, did you come down here last night?" Andy nodded. He waited, hoping Joanne would touch Phil again, make him stop talking, make him leave Andy alone. Andy thought about the doll sitting inside the living room. He thought about telling them that he wanted it out of his room, that he was afraid, that... But that would be even worse. "Why?" Phil asked. "Why did you come down here?"
I wanted something to eat."
"Okay, all right. You two leave me no choice. Until someone fesses up, you're both grounded."
"Oh, no,"
Kyle groaned.
"I have a date tonight. Come on, I told you."
"Sorry," Phil snapped. And Andy felt Kyle looking at him as if she wanted to throw him out the window. Kyle slammed down the lid to the washing machine, not caring whether Joanne and Big Phil heard the noise.
"They're up there,"
she thought,
"enjoying their tasty egg shakes, slurping up every last drop of gooey egg and orange pulp."
She turned the washer on. "You and Andy can do the laundry, Kyle," Joanne had said, just an extra added chore because the new runt is a pathological liar. Kyle walked to the sink and pulled out some of her special shirts that were soaking, too delicate for the mauling they'd get in the washer. And Andy just stood there watching her.
"Thanks a heap, Andy. This is exactly how I'd like to spend my Sunday. Stuck in a cellar, doing laundry, with a liar. Thanks a lot."
"But I didn't break the statue,"
he said. She looked at him. The naked light bulb caught his face, and for all her anger, she had to admit he looked a bit pathetic standing there.
"Yeah,"
she said.
"Well..."
She went on, turning back to the washer, waiting to dump the fabric softener into the churning mixture.
"Maybe it fell. Maybe a breeze."
She turned and looked at him.
"Maybe an earthquake,"
she said, grinning, and he made the smallest smile back. She took a look upstairs, up to the door that led to the kitchen, and then she dug a pack of Marlboros from her back pocket. She lit one and sucked hard. She felt Andy watching her, brainwashed by hours of anti-smoking ads.
God, now I'll have the kid ratting on me,
she thought.
Here, give me a hand hanging these shirts on the line. I can't put them in the dryer.
Kyle pulled out one shirt covered with silver spangles, one of her favorites. It ate two of her paychecks before she started saving for California. It should be dry clean, but that cost more money. Woolite was cheaper. She draped it over the line.
Hand me some clothespins,
she said. Andy dug a handful of them out of a bag. A few spilled to the floor. Kyle took one and clipped the shirt collar onto the indoor line. Then Andy tried to pin the other side of the shirt, but Kyle saw that he had bunched the material up.
No,
she said. She reached up and took the cigarette out of her mouth.
Hold this,
she said, handing him the cigarette. She pulled the collar and shoulder of the shirt tight. When she turned, Andy was staring at the burning cigarette in his hand. Then she saw him bring it up to his lips, as if sipping something hot and biting. He took a puff and immediately started coughing.
Andy!
She said, reaching out and grabbing the cigarette from his flailing hand. He was still bent over, coughing.
What do you think you're doing? God!
He said.
I wanted to taste it.
And you do everything you want to do? Get real, Andy. It tastes like garbage, okay? And you know how bad it is for you, right?
He finally stopped hacking and stood watching her, and asked her why she did it then. She went back to the clothesline, grabbing another shirt, a silky item, out of the sink.
Grown-ups are allowed to do things that are bad for them.
She took another puff off her cigarette, but it didn't taste that great anymore, not with Andy watching.
But you're not a grown-up.
She stared at him.
You know, you're really starting to get on my nerves, Andy. Really. Now the way you hang up the clothes is like...
She heard a sound, the door opening upstairs. Joanne, or Big Phil, coming down to inspect the prisoners. She flicked the half-done cigarette into the sink with her shirts and the gray, soapy water. The door opened farther. She heard Joanne's voice. Kyle waved at the air, trying to fan away the smoke. Andy saw what she was doing and then helped, his arms windmilling. Kyle gave him a smile. Maybe he's not such a bad runt after all. She heard Joanne's voice closer at the top of the stairs, and then the door shut again. She must have picked up something from one of the shelves that were on the way down to the cellar.
Thanks,
she said. Andy came closer. She saw him look up the stairs.
Mr. Simpson. Phil. He's kind of grouchy, isn't he?
Grouchy? I don't know. I've had worse foster parents. Much worse. I could tell you some horror stories. Hey, and you'd be grouchy too if you sold insurance 5 days a week.
What's insurance?
Kyle shrugged.
You pay money, you see. So if something bad happens to you, someone else gets a lot of money.
Why would you do that?
Kyle stepped back from the clothesline.
Beats me, kid. But he's not so bad. Believe me, there are some foster parents who would kill you for just looking cross-eyed at them.
Really?
Sure. I mean, they figure that you're not really theirs. You're just passing through, and the minute you screw up, they let you have it.
She leaned closer to Andy.
And I've gotten it real bad from some foster parents. That's why I'm getting out of here. That's why I'm saving money.
Andy nodded, and she saw that he was scared, standing in the dull light of the cellar, listening to the muffled voices of Joanne and Phil.
Hey, why don't you go on up? Go outside and play. I'll finish up this stuff.
Andy smiled. He was a cute kid, if only he weren't a little liar. But then she thought, maybe he's telling the truth. And if he was telling the truth, how the hell did that statue fall? She patted Andy's shoulder.
Go ahead, before the spiders start jumping off the ceiling at you.
Andy quickly looked around the gloomy basement, and Kyle laughed.
Go ahead.
Andy turned and went upstairs. Maybe Kyle isn't so bad, Andy thought, walking up the stairs. Maybe we could even be friends, he thought, as he neared the door leading to the kitchen. But as he got closer, he heard Phil and Joanne talking inside the kitchen, talking about him. He stopped just a few steps from the door and listened. How late were you up with him? It was Phil. He was talking loudly, as if he doesn't care if I hear, Andy thought. I'm fine, Joanne said. Her voice was quiet. Then Phil, even louder, said, No, you're not. You're exhausted. Andy knew what that meant. Mom used that word when she came home from work. I'm exhausted, Andy. I was on my feet all day, and I'm... Having second thoughts, Joanne said. But Andy was having a hard time hearing her. He looked down to see if Kyle noticed him stopped on the stairs listening. But she was at the clothesline. He took another step closer to the door. Well, hell, after last night, you have to admit that he's one very troubled little boy. He might be more than we can handle, Joanne. Andy licked his lips. He thought of the center again, the kids with their bruises, the crying, the sound of heavy shoes moving in the hallway at night. He obviously hasn't come to terms with this doll thing, that's for sure. It's the doll again, thought Andy. It's the good guy doll. It's not Chucky this time, but it's still getting me in trouble. Chucky's gone. Destroyed. Burned like a piece of bacon. But this new doll, just a doll, that's all. Tommy. He's getting me in trouble, Andy thought, because I'm scared of him. Phil's voice got low, and Andy could imagine Joanne's face looking sad. She likes me, he thought. Maybe she's my friend, too. All I'm saying is, he may need more attention than we can give him. Professional attention. It's more than we can handle. Andy felt frozen on the steps. He couldn't just walk into the kitchen now, smile at them, go outside and play on the swing. And he couldn't go back downstairs. Look, he heard Joanne say, he's been through hell, Phil. Just think about what he's seen. Can't we just give him some time? I just know he'll settle down. It's a new house and new people. Tomorrow, there's school. He'll be busy and... Andy waited, holding his breath. And besides, I like him. And then there was silence. Maybe they were holding hands. Maybe they were even kissing. Andy let his breath out. I like him, she had said. I like him. And Andy turned the doorknob and went into the kitchen. Andy opened the basement door quickly, trying to act as if he had just hurried up the stairs. Joanne and Phil both turned and smiled at him, and Andy smiled back. All done, champ? Phil asked. Andy nodded.
Kyle, she's just finishing a few of her shirts.
Joanne stood up, pulling her robe tight. Well then, you go on outside and play. Andy nodded. He forced a big smile and said,
I thought I'd play with Tommy, the good guy doll. I'll take him on a swing.
He saw Phil's smile broaden even more. Good idea, Joanne said. Andy moved past them out to the foyer and on into the living room. Now the room was drenched in sunlight, the morning light bouncing off the polished wood, reflecting from all the other statues. He went right to the chair to get Tommy, but the doll wasn't there. He stopped, frozen in his tracks. He thought of backing away, just running outside by himself. The doll wasn't there. But they would wonder why he had changed his mind. Phil would wonder. Andy licked his lips and looked around the room. Finally, he saw the doll sitting on the floor by the television. He walked over to it slowly. Someone must have moved it. Maybe Joanne, maybe Kyle, someone. Still, an idea haunted him. Chucky moved. Sure, Chucky could get around and do stuff, lots of stuff. Chucky could talk and run and kill. So why not this doll? He walked up to it slowly. The wood floor creaked under the carpet with each step he took. He was in front of the doll. He knelt down close to it, and he whispered,
I hate you.
The doll blinked. Its head swiveled, zeroing in right on Andy's face. Then it sang out,
Hi, I'm...
The next word didn't come right out. It hung there inside the doll just for a second, and then...
Tommy, and I'm your friend to the end. Heidi-ho!
Andy took a step backward. The doll went silent. He knew there was something to check. He heard sounds coming from outside the room, the sounds of Phil and Joanne cleaning up the kitchen. They'd come in here soon, and Andy didn't want them to see him standing there frozen, looking at the doll. He knelt down, quickly now, hurrying. He grabbed the doll by its midsection, roughly, squeezing it. He picked it up and turned it around. Then he pushed up the good guy t-shirt. It felt damp, just a bit. Just like when his mom put too many clothes in the dryer and they didn't quite completely dry. He flipped open the battery compartment and saw two batteries there, ever ready. Andy took a deep breath. There, he thought, this one has batteries. This one's just a toy. He grabbed the doll by one ankle and started dragging it out of the living room. The doll's head banged against the floor, but Andy didn't worry that it bumped against the chairs and the legs of the end tables. It's just a doll, he thought, a dumb doll. He saw Joanne and Phil coming out of the kitchen, arm in arm. Perfect, he thought.
Hi,
he said as cheerily as he could.
Hi. Hi,
they said back, both smiling. Andy then thought,
Phil can see me with the doll. He can see me playing with it.
Then Andy said,
I'm going out to play with Tommy.
He opened the front door and dragged the doll outside, down the steps, and around to the backyard. Chucky felt each bang just as if he were in his own body and some wise guy gorilla was putting the moves on him, hustling him for a late payment on his last big loan. Bang! His head slapped against the floor and bang! His plastic cheek smacked the coffee table leg. The kid is doing it on purpose, he thought, smacking me around, all on purpose. And then Andy ran down the front porch stairs as fast as he could, letting Chucky's head trail behind. His head smacked each wooden step just a bit harder. But that's okay, he thought. I don't mind the pain. No, time is getting short. Already I'm changing. Too fast. But things are going along according to plan, just beautifully. Here I am, right next to Andy. Christ, he's got to keep me with him, or old Phil and Joanne will get nervous, and we don't want that Andy boy now, do we? So what if he bangs me around? Soon he'll be in this stupid doll's body, and I'll be the real boy. It's a regular little Pinocchio story. And don't worry, Andy Barclay, after the change is all done, don't worry at all. You can be my friend till the end. I guarantee it. Okay, Slashaholics. This has been Chapter 12 of Child's Play 2. And before I start discussing the chapter, I want to first say, again, thank you to Cecilia Spears and Bonanza Jellybean. They are both $15 patrons on the Patreon page for the channel, and because of that, they get to voice characters in these audiobooks, and Bonanza Jellybean is voicing Andy, and Cecilia Spears is voicing Kyle, and they were the stars of tonight's upload, I believe. And great job, gals. Y'all did awesome. I just love having y'all being a part of this, and I look forward to all the audiobooks you're going to be a part of in the future. And with that being said, I thought Chapter 12, which is one of the longest chapters so far, was a really good chapter. A lot of character development went on between Andy and Kyle, And even Joanne and Phil, you know, in the movie, Joanne and Phil are kind of throwaway characters, really. They're just like caricatures of foster parents. But they're a lot deeper here, and so is Kyle. And in a sense, so is Andy. And you want to go even further, so is Chucky. But I'm a huge Chucky fan, a huge slasher fan. You guys know that if I wasn't as big a fan as I am of the slasher genre, there's no way this channel would exist. So I feel kind of stupid, unless this is just something the book covers and not the movies, but I always thought that if Chucky finished off his Ah De Due Dembella chant thing, you know, the voodoo spell, and put his soul into Andy, that Andy would essentially be dead. But I thought it was quite interesting at the end of the chapter here, we find out that no, it would be like from Seed of Chucky, where it's like, and switch, you know, and Andy would be in the doll. See, I knew that they did the switch thing in Seed of Chucky, but I thought that was like a different variation of the spell, to be honest with you. So it kind of threw me off here a little bit at the end. I was like, wow, okay, so if he had succeeded, Andy would have been in the good guy doll. Okay, that's interesting. And if that is just something for the book and they didn't, you know, because obviously I don't think that was mentioned in the movie, then yeah, that's pretty cool. But yeah, let's see here. I think it's funny being in Chucky's head and him just getting pissed off and more pissed that he's getting banged around, but at least he's observing enough to know that he needs to find a way to keep Andy interested in the doll, to stay close to Andy, because he realizes the foster parents would start worrying if Andy all of a sudden quit playing with the good guy doll. It's like, even though I've seen this movie, I'm just loving the hell out of this book, guys. And as far as like the actual good guy doll voice, I thought the only way I could do that for the book was to use the actual clips of it, you know, the hidey-ho, ha-ha-ha. And I'm glad I made that choice. I don't think I could have done that as much justice. And I just think there's something creepy about having the actual voice from the good guy doll. And I hope you guys like that too. You know, the whole, hi, I'm Tommy. You know, using that clip. Let me know if you guys think that voice is creepy too. The one from the movies that I'm using here in the audiobook for the good guy doll. And let me know what you thought of tonight's chapter. And maybe give a nice shout-out to Cecilia and Bonanza for doing a great job as Kyle and Andy. And I'll be back very soon with more of Child's Play 2. Until then, this has been your friendly neighborhood 80s slasher librarian saying, thanks for listening, and give me the likes, I beg of you. See you guys next time.
There's a lover in the story, but the story's still the same. There's a lullaby for suffering and a paradox to blame. But it's written in the scriptures and it's not some idle claim. You want it darker. We kill the flame. They're lining up the prisoners and the guards are taking aim. I struggled with some demons, they were middle class and tame. I didn't know I had permission to murder and to maim. You want it darker? Human frame, a million candles burning for